A long time ago, in a community college system far, far away. Visual description says, dark screen with no words. Before there was funding, there was Steve Fasteau and his wardrobe Jedi Advocates. Well, thank you guys for joining us. We'll get some lights going here. So we really wanted to have some fun with this, and just to share the origin story and how this came about. We definitely want to share knowledge and experiences of the disability professionals, but there's more of a personal connection for me. I wanted to share with you guys that I'm a Special Resource Center, DSPS, from Camino College graduate. So I myself have a disability, and it's because of those people in the room, but specifically Lucinda and Lyn Clemons, Ray Lovell, Steve Fasteau, the effort that they put forward allows me to be on my track in here today. So it's a very personal sharing that I wanted to share with you guys, in hopes of generating also enthusiasm in the conversation. Ideally, I would like to do this as a pre-conference presentation next KPET, but the entire state of California. Today, we're going to talk about El Camino College, Cerritos College, and KPET, and the start of disability services there. But if you're interested, we're looking for volunteers for next year so we can really expand this out and really get a big picture of how this works, okay? Show of hands. Why are we looking at it? I'm here in less than 5 years of disability services. Okay? Awesome. How many over 15 years? Okay, anybody retired from disability services or soon to be retired?
I should be
now. So the reason I'm asking these questions is we need to, and KPET is already doing a great job of this, connecting people with disabilities, support services that is. I just feel that we want to make sure that we remember the history and keep that connection. Lucinda's done a phenomenal job of creating a mentorship program with KPET, and it's for directors and coordinators. Are we on year two now?
Three.
Year three now. How many are involved with this? I saw if you could see. Awesome.
Yay.
So what I want to see is what else can we do for the rest of us that are not at the program, the coordinator at the DSPS director position. So that's where this conversation comes in. So, but thank you all for being here. Oh, did I forget to say my name was Brian Krause?
Yeah.
So on the next slide, we will introduce ourselves. So.
Hi, I'm Lucinda Aborn, and I'm the Dean of Disabled Student Services at Cerritos College. And as Brian mentioned, I'm also the coordinator for the KPED Mentorship Program to continue the legacy.
I can't even match that. I'm Lyn Clemons. I am the Alpedia Supervisor for Alpedia College. I was the first person that Steve Fasteau hired because he allowed him to hire a student helper back in the 70s. And I've kind of been there ever since. Took a few breaks, but. And so I may be the, I'm not sure what the legacy is for my college. I have to say, I'm a student with disability before they identify disability. KPED and the possibilities of crossing over with the professionals and talking with the kind of students involved with KPED is an exciting opportunity. And later on, we find out that the advocacy that was started by the KPED and how it got going really relies on all of the professionals in California, as well as all the students in all the four systems, to help with the advocacy, because that's the biggest changes I think were made in legislation in county of the year. That was my commercial.
Cool. My name is Ryan Krause. I'm an AT specialist at El Camino College. I've been in disability services for well over 20 years, and an AT specialist for well over 20 years now. So I myself, like I mentioned earlier, have a disability. Did not find out I had one until age 25, so I never thought college was possible. I got tested at El Camino College, found out I had a disability, and one of my favorite days of my life, I was like, yay! I'm not stupid, I just learned it. So I was really excited to find out that I had a disability, because I really didn't think I was college material. And it was through the disability services that I found how to become a better student, how to study, how to learn my strengths and weaknesses, and scheduling, and extra time on tests, and before you knew it, here I barely passed high school. I graduated with honors in college, and found my career in AT specialist and a passion for training others, and now I get to pass that on, and not technology, but also as I'm one of you, not just a hair club for me, you know, like old commercial web. You might have people in here not know that you're visual, right? Anyway, so now let's next slide. All right, so today's session overview. Like we mentioned earlier, we're going to talk about two long-time DSPS programs. We're going to talk about bios on Steve, Bob, and Ray, because Bob and Ray, they were supposed to join us this weekend, but they weren't able to make it, so we'll talk a little bit for them. We're going to discuss the funding then and now, technology then and now, support services then and now. We're going to talk about KPED, and we're going to show some images of past KPED, or pictures that we've collected and that I've scanned from our communiques, and you may see a few faces in there you may know. And what's next? And becoming DSPS, quote, Jedi Advocates. What's the next step? We kind of know what that is. But we're glad to have you here. Thank you.
Is there any expectations from any of you that you're hoping to get from us that we didn't include in that list? Because we can
squirrels?
Yeah.
So we wanted to show this picture. Rancho Los Amigos, 1969. Is anyone familiar with this picture? I was hoping that maybe we could find someone in here. There's a few of us. Well, so if I'm not mistaken, this is Bob Hughlett and Steve Fasteau,
the bearded one.
Now, my understanding, there's some other DSPS Jedis in here. I'm just not familiar with who they are, so I'm hoping to track down more information by the next KPED. But my perspective is this is where it all started. They all worked together as faculty in Rancho Los Amigos in 1969, and from there they went on to Cerritos College, and then on to bigger and better things and move forward.
And Rancho Los Amigos is a national rehabilitation hospital, and when their program grew to look at the educational needs of students or individuals with disabilities. Rancho is in the city of Downey, and it's currently operated as a Los Angeles County hospital, and it has many individuals that after their rehabilitation move on to education, and the surrounding college campuses are actually, Cerritos is the closest to Rancho Los Amigos, and there was an automatic partnership there with the rehab program and higher education, so that individuals could continue to pursue their education and go beyond injury and their rehabilitation.
And Bob and Steve worked with the pre-adolescents and the high school students who might have come in for surgery, and it was mostly residential as well, because someone would be in for surgery or some spinal cord repair, and they could be in that hospital for the whole semester. And then when they were able to, they made that agreement with Cerritos, to where when Bob went to Cerritos, students who were able to continue their education at Cerritos as well. So it's been a beta group testing, the significance of keeping preteens, adolescents, and young adults in the school system and finding out that they can't do things. That was kind of good.
Okay, I want to talk a little bit about Steve.
Steve, what can you say about Steve? Steve came to Camino in the 70s, right when the when they first decided 504 money was going to come down for disabled programs and services. And so he kind of came in with a little whirlwind. He's been a little whirlwind almost all of his life. We have him at Steve Fasteau, and he was mentoring up until a year ago. His passion was making sure that the institution took accountability and responsibility, making sure that we were accessible. Sometimes it worked really well for him, and other times it didn't. I think all of us had the same experiences. How many of you have institutional services integrated into your campus culture? Or do they still call DSP&S for your help? How many have it integrated into their system so that you are an additional service that complements students with disabilities on your campus? And how many of you have had trouble institutionalizing it because of how the campus is run? More of it. So that's another thing for the next generation. We need to shift it up. It's been 30 years where the institution's had an opportunity to flip, and we haven't, so we can now flip it. So, Steve was at Rancho's Amigos, came to Cerritos as well. When he came to help Camino College, all the preteens and adolescents that he worked with at Rancho, who hated him because he made him work, three of them were friends of mine that lived up the street. And so when I said, oh, we got this guy over here, you can come to college, why don't you come over? He said, okay. And then when he found out it was Steve, they had to come in and give him a hard time and then continue their college education. So kind of a love-hate funny thing for them to do. And then for KPED, man, he and Bob and a whole bunch of people, we have a history of VR. Interested that he helps with it for the first round. There was a lot of KPED people who went ahead with Steve and Bob and put together some really important things that ended up with some legislative changes.
He was, for those who don't know, he was our first KPED president. He was part of the founding members as well. How many years? 44 years.
44 years, yep.
And we'll be going over more information as well throughout the presentation.
And Dr. Bob Hughlett, who you also saw at the beginning, the picture from Rancho Los Amigos, started the Disability Services Program, DSPS, at Cerritos College. When he started the program, there was a strong relationship between the Rehabilitation Hospital and Cerritos College, actually establishing a classroom of Cerritos College at the hospital, and then together the students could transfer into the Cerritos College and continue their education. That continued from the late 70s all the way into the early 2000s, 2008. The classroom remained on the campus and students could then continue their education. Bob was also the president of KPED in 2007 through 9. And then he was also a board of trustee member at Cerritos College for 8 years after that. And then was also very active in the community of Cerritos and was mayor of Cerritos. So our legacy has roots as we look at our Jedi from the partnership that was able to be established in the roots of Rancho Los Amigos Rehabilitation Hospital.
So now Ray Lovell was good friends with Bob Hewlett, and Lyn knows a little bit more about this. Bob talked Ray into getting his teaching credential?
Yeah, Ray's a Vietnam vet. He was a coder and translator in the Vietnam War in the Demilitarized Zone. He came back from the service, and Bob said, hey, why don't you get a certificate of teaching credential and work with the disabled? So he went over to Cal State LA. At that time, he had a bachelor's and a master's, I think, in economics and business. And so then he went and got his degree and got, then ended up at Whitney High School, teaching there, doing some, a couple years there, and then ended up at El Camino in 1977 to do the physically disabled specialist at El Camino College. He also worked with KFIT since, all of us worked with KFIT since 1977. And then he also was part-time teachers over at Cerritos College and doing he worked with you for a while, didn't he? And he also is quite involved with this community, also involved with the vet program, was one of the people that helped push and advertise for the veterans to join the veteran centers that were on the community college campuses. And he's also active with the Optimists and working with international projects as well. I'd like to read one thing, if that's okay. Paul Colton, he's he was a deaf, an advocate for deaf education in Kentucky in the late 60s, early 70s. He too came to California. He too worked with Bob and Ray and Steve, and was also active in KFED. More on the, come on, guys, we gotta do something. We're not doing enough. So he wrote, imagine a world before 1970s. Very few people with disabilities considered post-secondary education, and they were generally not considered very good material for college or vocational schools. Those individuals who did apply were faced with insurmountable barriers. Almost no support services were available. Architecturally and attitudinal barriers were the rule, and those few brave souls who survived, persisted, were exceptional ones. So the group of people that came in who wanted to be advocates for students came in from that environment and wanted to make sure that that isn't going to be the case next year or forever. So that kind of sets the groundwork of the advocacy and the KFED organization.
Great. I just wanted to add a piece. I consider myself to be part of Ray's legacy. He started the High Tech Center at El Camino College, and he's the first one to see something in me, even before I saw it in myself. Hired me as an 18 trainer, as an hourly 18 trainer. So he saw potential in me that I didn't see. So I trusted his vision, so I continued on that path, even when I didn't have faith in myself. So as I work with 18 training and training our students, I always have his thoughts and his legacy in my mind.
In the 70s, he took a tour. Before this, the Epilepsy Campus Actions, Steve traveled to Berkeley and had lunch with a guy who convinced deaf students with disabilities not only to succeed in higher education, but had the right to try. This guy was a quadriplegic with a respirator somehow attached to his wheelchair. Do any of you know who that is?
Ed Roberts,
right. And Ed, and he, and if you don't know Ed Roberts, he's the man who established the first Center for Independent Living, now at UC Berkeley. Ed went on to become a director of California State Department of Rehabilitation. He played a significant role testifying before congressional committees and for the 504 regulations in the American with Disabilities Act. So again, it was a KPED Jedi who worked with state legislators and other key people in the community to get more of an inclusive environment going.
And so as the evolution continued, as the foundation had been established for categorically funded programs within the community colleges, an opportunity to serve students, and to greater or lesser extent, an opportunity for students to advocate for themselves. And the programs continued to evolve and provide services, both educational support accommodations, as well as assistive technology and training. And in the 2000s, the California Community Colleges faced an extraordinary challenge that was posed to us based on findings and recommendations from the Office for Civil Rights. They actually did a system-wide analysis after they found difficulties at one particular college, and then mandated that all colleges establish better services for providing support for students who are low vision or blind and learning disabled. And in 2000, we received additional funding to establish both personnel, pay for equipment, and provide support for converting materials into alternate formats. After that time, it began to get more recognition because those were dollars that had to be spent towards giving those particular support services for students. So the chancellor's office said, this is your money to do this role. And we did, and those dollars continue to exist today. And with that recognition, most campuses then began to evolve their own on-campus institutional policy for providing support to electronic and technology and be able to provide better access. And it began to get some recognition of what institutions need to do. And by establishing a board policy, we were able to move El Camino forward. I failed to mention I'm currently at Cerritos College, but prior to that I was at El Camino. I was at El Camino for 13 years. So it was an opportunity to see both those legacy Jedis.
And as a legacy person, Lucinda, what happened the first day you were there?
Oh, yes. Sorry. I was to start at El Camino College, but the Northridge earthquake happened. I was a little bit delayed. I was in the epicenter.
Yeah. Yeah.
Northridge didn't want to let go of Lucinda.
It was an earth-shaking experience. Yes.
And her experience from El Camino allowed her to go to Cerritos and get right in.
Right. So the evolution of the process when categorical funding expanded beyond the general services and began to take a look at specialized support helped institutions to recognize their responsibility in providing access for students with disabilities. And policies continued to pass across the state. Now, to remember, technology in the early 2000s wasn't real advanced. We actually called it electronic information and technology, and that since has changed, but those were the early days as we began to look at institutional responsibility through board policy. And then it continued to evolve into more recent. As you heard, the California State Auditors in December of 2017 again audited three specific campuses as well as the system, and again cited that we weren't doing the job that we should have been doing back in 2000. The Office for Civil Rights said we needed to provide access in a timely manner to electronic and alternate media. So you may have heard about the audit. The audit was an opportunity for the system to take a look at what was timely and effective delivery of alternate media. And then in July of 18, as a result of that, the community colleges chancellor's office then issued findings or information and guidelines standards that allow us to know what we need to do. And that's information that all community college system institutions need to provide by it. Providing standards for instructional materials to be available, accessible for all students.
And then how many of you are familiar with the Chancellor's Office for Technology and Accessibility and or also for the IT? Both offices will do an audit, not a reportable audit to the Chancellor's Office, but if you're interested in seeing what the status of your campus is in regards to accessibility and to meeting the guidelines for institutional responsibility and inclusion, you can ask Sean to run an audit and give it back to you so you can see what parts of campus may not be doing what they've been due diligence or may have difficulties with this audit moving forward.
It's a great way to bump your people into position for those on campus that may not understand how far behind they actually are. Sometimes you need that little kick in the butt.
And with the audit, for those campuses that didn't use their 504 monies to expand the services on their campus for DSP&S students, so some of them used the 508 money for that, and that's where some of the audit issues came up too, where the money was not meant to create a DSPS program. It was to expand the services of DSPS throughout the institution, and the institution did accountability and responsibility.
So funding has come a long way. So we wanted to give you the more recent picture of what has happened as a result of funding availability. But in the early days, when we were early adopters of specialized equipment and technology, we didn't have a lot of money. And at that time, technology was quite expensive. And so we actually would go through efforts to gather other additional funds, fundraising efforts, to be able to help us to be able to fund the technology that our students needed. Categorical dollars, as I mentioned before, from the California Community Colleges set aside monies to provide services to students with disabilities, and then began to move forward towards specialized support, such as alternate media and text production, and later then on to deaf and hard of hearing support services. So that those are actually in existence today. You are actually, each one of the California Community Colleges allocation must be designated to show exactly that those dollars were spent as intended by the specialized funds that for that purpose for students with disabilities. In addition, as that began to work towards how colleges spent their dollars, it's never been intended that categorical dollars would serve students with disabilities and be enough money. And so colleges are required to contribute a certain amount of effort in order to be able to support the program beyond what categorical dollars will cover. And so legislation continues to support that college effort requirement. And this next coming year, the college effort from the funding formula for DSPS will be actually a greater requirement in the overall funding to categorical programs. So the system is saying, we want colleges to do more. We know the importance of categorical dollars to establish a foundation, but it's never intended to be enough. And again, pushing towards the institution to provide additional funding over and above and demonstrate effort towards support of that program. And what will happen is that the greater the effort that has been demonstrated will continue to go on as far as showing then that you've met that effort in your overall funding and you're rewarded by additional dollars. Keeps popping out there.
Every time I turn
it. Yeah, I know. And by showing that college effort is required and the percentages going from higher from what they were from before, that there'll be penalties for funding that will be reduced if your college doesn't provide the effort. And so that continues, as I showed in the previous slide, a commitment towards establishing institutional responsibility through the establishment of policies, as I mentioned before, but also dollars. So don't just say that it's required and put it in your board policy and show instructors what their responsibility is, but go beyond that because of the cost that is required to run a DSPS program. So college effort will be part of a greater portion of the funding formula, and institutions need to take that responsibility. And interestingly enough, institutional responsibility has also shown up in the information and communication technology standards, which I mentioned before, and we'll talk, that was a result of the audit that just came out this July. It also points to the importance of the institution taking full responsibility for implementing access to information and communication technology, and that the standards are requiring that institutional responsibility, and it must be in a timely manner for the production of access for students with any type of disability. So the thing is carrying on, and you need to continue to work with your institutions to assure that they're responsible. I think that's...
These are two of my favorite photos. I have a very fondness for history, especially when it comes to the Special Resource Center at Oklahoma College. And I don't know how I got all these those, but I think someone trying to get rid of them, so I grabbed them with all these books, and I came across these two. And this is before there was funding. And Lyn, since you're in these pictures, why don't you tell us about writing for books?
I'm the cute one. I look very similar. But basically what happened is the technology and people and the campuses were using computers and that type of stuff. So I thought, you know, we were having that same issue where all of a sudden the teachers were like, hey, you have to do it on a computer. And the students are going, I say, what? Is there a screen reader? What can I do? So, and we couldn't get funding from the institution for a lab or upgrades to the computers that we did have. So Ray went ahead, that's part of the Optimist community networking group, these type of thing. He goes, Reagan, right. Well, part of it is you have to realize that one, Ray lived in Hawthorne as he grew up. And then when his father ended up being over in Saudi Arabia, he went and finished high school in Italy because when you live in Saudi Arabia, you go to Italy for school, I guess. And then he came back here. So he was a local kid. So he knew he could go on the bicycle through Compton down to the river and go all the way to San Diego. And he was at that time getting fed. And his wife, who also knows Bob Hughlett, is here. And so she was game. This is before she realized she didn't like camping and she didn't really like bicycle riding. So she was game for being on a tandem. So they got a tandem and how many of you know Sharon Costa, who used to be in the LD Consortium? Okay. Well, then she was a biker, so she joined us as well. So we had two tandems going and two single bikes. But then we went from Camino to Mission Park down in San Diego. And we did that, I think, for about 5 to 6 years. And raised enough money to upgrade the computers, or at least the assistive technology on the computers, so that students could still be competitive in what they were needing to do for school and classes. Ray was also involved with the High Consent Training Project. So if you have anyone on your campus who is one of the legacy people who helped make that happen, hi Lori, how are you doing? and there's 3 or 4 people that helped push that one through and then got that one started as well. So the biking for bucks was another way of making money when it came down to where the institution did not have it out. So just remember that you too can ride the 200 mile bike ride and on your annual basis in order to get money to upgrade your computers. Or you can work with your campus and have them be aware that you are a vital person and the resources in DSPS are vital and the resources for access on campus are vital. And that will let and save yourself the 200 mile bike ride.
But Ray estimates that they raised $30,000 in 5 years, matching funds from Northrop and Disabled American Veterans Charities.
Yeah, so he went out to the other charities and matching funds on that kind of stuff.
So before we had funding, they got technology bought for the High Tech Center by riding bikes to San Diego.
And it legitimized it enough by having community partners help match grants.
Julie.
So there were 5 annual bike rides?
Yes.
I knew there was a bike ride, but
well, how many of you know Bill Hansel? He's got that little limp. That's because he rode a single bike, and then he ended up spilling out on the traffic circle in Long Beach. But being a triathlete that he is, he got back up and continued riding all the way down to San Diego. And so I think the bike that we've added to our disabled employees too.
It just shows the dedication, right? We're talking about our Jedi Advocates that came before us, the dedication that they did to support our students. That meant a lot to me when I found the story. Okay, so one of my favorite images. This is El Camino College's first accessible and mobile computer. See, for those that are... Anyways, it's my funny sense of humor. You have Ray Lovell, who's actually has a push and manual wheelchair that's supporting an old Windows 95 computer and monitor, which is super heavy. So that's why I started first mobile. Actuality, it's IT is very slow on campus, so trying to get our computers to the other side of campus for our students, this is what we had to do because it was so heavy.
I think that's the one that went to the library.
It was. Yeah. So it's just, yeah, I thought that'd be fun. Okay.
So So we have another picture of our illustrious Jedi, Dr. Steve Fasteau, overlooking students in our high tech center, helping them achieve success through looking at tactile graphics and other technology. And the technology then required, it was pretty labor intensive. It was highly specialized. You had to perform a lot of different functions. We typically had to tailor it to an individual's disability, and oftentimes it wasn't usable for others, so it was just an individualized support class by class by class. And it was very expensive. Not only the technology costs sometimes upwards of $34,000 just for one piece of equipment, it was also labor intensive. So it was the interaction with the student that was labor intensive to assure that it met their needs and the accommodation for their particular type of disability, but also labor intensive post-production to be able to help assure that the next class could be met in the same manner. So we've come a long time, a long ways, but DSPS bore the whole responsibility for not only the cost of the equipment, but the personnel time to develop it in an accessible format.
I think when Steve's up there, the other thing that Steve did, and I know it probably happened on your campuses too, but you may not be aware of it, students with disabilities were not encouraged to go to scholarships or do any of the fundraising or do any of the elements that would help them get scholarships and grants. So Steve worked with one of our students who was had graduated from UCLA. He was a part of the Google Fall, and he's got a movie called Gravity Is My Enemy. Steve matched up with Mark Hicks, and Mark, while he was a student in class at our campus, was able to do some fundraising that raised quite a bit of money for Disabled Student Center scholarships and assistance. So again, some of the things that we have now started out with grassroots, and when they look at the budget, sometimes those things go away because they don't know how they got on the budget. Sometimes memory helps to remind your institutions why it's on the budget line.
So the evolution of the high tech center. So here's an image on the left of one of our original high tech centers. And it's before computers. They're actually sitting, you have two students that are disabled sitting at computer desks. They're not computer desks, they're actually typewriters. So it's pre-computers. And as technology changed, the one on the right, we have someone that's using assistive technology to access one of the first computers. And the key to remember is, back then, the SRC, or the Disability Service High Tech Center, was the only place to go on campus to get services for technology. It's just, it's come a long way. So now we're more integrated on campus. Students have technology that are in their hands, so it's they can get trained on devices that they bring in versus what only we have available and that kind of stuff. So we've come a long way since the days where we'd only had typewriters to create paper with and stuff. So.
And the image on the left is a student using a head stick accessing a keyboard in front of a 1970s computer?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, that's a, you could go by the shirt that Ray's wearing too. Okay, so evolution of the high tech center, right? So this is 1987, 1988. The grant from the California Community Colleges Foundation and DOR. Anyone of you guys want to talk about the grant?
The Department of Rehabilitation provided funding for, some campuses actually had to compete for it in setting up accessible technology. That was very early on, and it continued to grow as technology became more accessible.
In the 87 and 88 years when the DOR was really partner-oriented and willing to do, let's make a deal. So I can remember also during that period of time, if there were services not available in the summertime because of, you may have 10-month employees instead of 12-month employees, a student who may need an interpreter could use DOR and do partnering. It was a shared responsibility. Hopefully we get back to that type of thing. And then with the partnership showing that there is a need for computers and training for staff and for students, Carl Brown, which would be part of the CAPE head legislative Jedi groupies. He's been around for quite a while, and he was one of the ones that would be probably on the same order of Ed Roberts, Ed for Independent Living, and Carl for Technology Access. And he was quite active in making sure that something happens. He worked with the Chancellor's Office then to create the specially funded grant program that became the High Tech Center Training. And if you've gone up for training for that, that's no longer, it's been absorbed into the Chancellor's Office of Accessibility now. But so it's gone, its own evolution. But they were up for that one. The four colleges, and it was El Camino and Butte, I think. Or do you know the other two colleges were that did the beta test on that?
We applied. We were at San Monica, San Barbara,
El Camino, and Butte then?
So again, we need to find more information to tie this all together. So it's,
there was four that beta tested in the next year. That there was quite a few others that came in.
I'm sure I have it in my garage.
It's in Marty's garage.
I've heard rumors that there are several people that have garages full of pictures. So I'm hoping that we can gather some of these pictures really to an all-encompassing level.
And training was provided them to, because it's so highly specialized, we had to have train-the-trainer kinds of sessions that would help spread the information on how to work with your students and use the technology.
So that was grade level from our campus, some of the others.
And you learned the fundamentals of DOS. Does anyone not know what DOS is? Because there's going to come a day when people don't know what DOS is. We're going to have to explain it. Before Windows. Some of the other things you guys learned.
We're in the world of Carmen Sandy.
WordStar, and there's a bunch of technology in there too, so in large brain. I found this to be, being a tech geek, these are the four computers that they, each of the, those computers, four campuses receive these types of computers, right? Mm-hmm. So if, for those of you that are tech savvy, they had an 8-bit data bus.
Ooh.
I don't even know the last time I heard bit, you know, we're talking terabytes these days. So they have dot matrix printers, and then I love the fact that when I asked Ray about this, he put down that three of the computers had dual floppy disk drives.
That was an innovation in its time. It's about time to be more than one.
So I'm hoping.
Maybe you all don't know what a floppy looks like.
Has anyone not used a floppy before?
It looks like a record. How many people know what a record? Well, they find it.
I'm hoping to find some pictures of these computers as well. But I just wanted to add.
Ray may have them in his garage.
Really high tech and cutting edge at the top.
Yeah.
And see what you look like when you're younger. So we should take pictures of all of you now, so we can show them later in about 30 years.
So we have two images on the screen. On the left is Ray Lovell sitting down and doing a lecture for his Ed Development 40 class. And on the right, we have one of his students that is using sip and glove technology in front of the Windows 95 machine. So we've actually got up a little bit here on a large screen. Monitor that probably weighed about 50 to 70 pounds. I was around at this time, so I remember it was heavy.
I think it still has a floppy drive.
Yes, it does.
Yeah. The grant made it possible for Ed Development 40 to be for a curriculum, and he did. It was a two-unit, non-transferable course. It was lecture and lab, and it was the first class that I took at El Camino College, and the first computer class that I took that set me on my way to find out that I was good on the computer. And I do remember the first day in class, and I was scared to death of computers. So students coming in today that don't know technology feel the exact same way I did some years ago.
And with that, in the 70s, when the Bible formally came down, each campus took a campus approach to how they wanted to grow their DSP&S office. There wasn't a guideline that all of us would do something. For Steve, it was really, really important to him that there was an educational component too. Because he wanted to be able to teach and influence and encourage students to do stuff, and wanted to have control over curriculum that was developed for those students, so they can be competitive in the mainstream classes, as well as the support services that that we all are mandated to do. So that's why sometimes you might be, how many of you are under the VP of Student Services in your campus? Okay. And how many of you are under the Academic Affairs of your campus, the VP of Academic Affairs. So Al Camino, for Steve, was really...
And how many of you are under an executive vice president? That's both student services and academic.
Yeah, so the, some campuses have gotten created an executive, like Santa Barbara. And with that one for Santa Barbara, kudos over the years, the last 30 years, they have integrated quite a few of their systems into other places. They have managerial support and understanding on all different levels. We need people from Santa Barbara. They're aware of what's needed to be done for students with disabilities or employees with disabilities. So kudos to Santa Barbara because they reached change of their managerial structure to be, you know, not under an academic side or a student service side, but under an executive side.
Educational Development 40 was a basic computer literacy, access to device, and introduction to application software course. So it's come a long way since then, but it still supports AT technology and students learning technology to help them succeed in higher ed.
And so these were what were called in the past special classes, so that the FTS generated by these particular classes contributed to the DSPS funding formula and allocation. They're now called educational assistance courses. So these were the early days of having courses that were designed for students with disabilities, were approved through the curriculum committee, allowed students to gain units, and sometimes transferable units, and contributed towards their educational process.
Yes, I just wanted to add, I had the good fortune to observe Ray a few times, and he really gave students a sense of the evolution of the computers. He'd bring photos from back in the day when the computer was floor to ceiling and he'd pass around, you know, old computer parts. I just thought I'd throw in that today the course is transferable. It has the digit one in front of it, and it's you know, been taken over with great expertise by Tiffany Lau at our campus.
So again, the legacy goes on and it's been integrated into the mainstream academic side. That's as far as transferability.
Kudos. Good job.
At the bottom of the screen, there's a quote from Steve Fasteau. It is providing real access to education, which in turn is providing real access to employment, which is really important for Steve.
Yeah, and that's, I think, during the 70s, it was nice to be able to partner with DOR because the Department of Rehab allowed that pathways to go through. And this is an interesting review of pathways again, guys. Pathways to employment. Hopefully, it'll be as beneficial as and as robust as it was in the 70s. And hopefully, stay a little longer.
How many of you are familiar with Kurzweil? How many of you are familiar with the first Kurzweil reading machine?
No.
All right.
And that's not it.
No, this is the Kurzweil reading edge, and we still have, I wanted to bring it. I really wanted to bring it, and because it still works, and I was going to do a test and everything, but maybe next year. But Ray, you want to talk about you and write the grant for the Kurzweil Foundation?
Yeah, but there's, you know how you get those obscure emails that say, hey, you want to go for a grant, and you go, ah, I don't want to do that one. What happened is an email came down saying, hey, Kurzweil's looking for someone to want to be able to use us. What's up? We're lucky to be in the LA area. At that time, I think Stevie Wonder had just purchased his. So it was kind of in the news in our area. And so what happened is we put in for the grant, we got one of the big ones. My best, I liked it because we had a music major who was totally blind, who did music theory. But one of the biggest things that he liked to do was calculus in his head. And when we got that one, it also came with the first auditory scientific calculator built into it. And so he would go, quit, let's do a test. And he would do it in his head, and I would do it on the computer. And he won most of the time, all the time. He was just excited to have a calculator that would be able to confirm that he was right. And that's where technology, I think, works a lot for our students. Not so much that they have to rely on it, but just to confirm that they can do it and that they understand what they're processing. And there's a way to show another person beyond the disability, beyond seeing their disability, what they are able to do. So how many of you know that Kurzweil was bought out by Xerox? So a couple years into it, Raymond Kurzweil went on to be a futurist and working with his and what he was doing with the synthetic and the programming part. Xerox bought it for the voicing and the intelligence of the programming that works on personal choices. And it was looking at wanting to be able to incorporate that into coffee machines and answer machines and all those other things that we now use for granted. When they did that, we happened to have a counselor at our campus who's like worked for Xerox, and then they had a grant going for anyone that might be interested in the new Kurzweil. So that's the second generation of Kurzweil, where it was able to be a standalone item that we could put in the library. People could scan their page on it, it could read it back to them. The student had control over how they want it read and all of these parameters. So that's how we ended up with that one. And then
the original grant had only 200 of these small foot locker size machines given out to the United States. There was only three in the Southern California area, which was Cal State University Dominguez Hills, Cal State University Long Beach, and El Camino College.
And most of that's from the CAPED network. We have band together and figured out before, and whoever got close enough, great, we both, all three of us received it. And Raymond Kurzweil invented the Kurzweil reading machine for his daughter. She was born with a visual impairment and wanted to make sure that she would be able to read books by the time she got to college. So it went through all the beta testing. So the first beta test was after. Yeah. I'm sorry. Do you remember?
We're thinking that Steve is messing with the planes. Because the screen keeps going on.
Okay, now, what you might not know about Steve, even though he liked technology, and even though he always was meticulous and anal and attention to detail on the documents that he's posted, if you see any of the articles in the CAPED Journal and stuff, the one thing he wasn't extremely good at was following directions. So like and he could be messing with you, because basically what he would do is, well, I don't like that, I go, and then go away, and then you have to come back and, okay, what key did you hit this time? And yeah, he would come. I didn't say anybody was
Well, the estimated cost of the original prototype was $30,000 to $50,000. The reading edge on the right was $5,500. And today, KNFB Reader has a $100 app that can go onto your phone. And Microsoft AI has a similar product for free. At the bottom of your screen, there's I believe, our ECC student,
yep.
Right? Yeah. Made a comment, a statement in the newspaper on campus years ago that says, the time will come when most blind persons will be able to own their own personal KRM.
Well, guess what? 1978.
Time is now. Yeah. So it's pretty interesting to go back to the 70s, 80s, and then where we are today, and how far it's come.
And I think that's where Ray Kurzweil would want to go, too. So,
yeah.
Kind of exciting that CAPED and most of our campuses are part of that beta group of changing all of our stuff.
So I reached out to Ray, and since he couldn't make it, I asked him to send me some information. This is a quote that I wanted to read to you guys from Ray. And it shows a picture of Ray shaking hands with Steve Fasteau at his retirement. In Ray's face, you can see the admiration and gracefulness that he has for Steve. I would like to stress the profound contributions made by both Dr. Stephen Fasteau and Carl Brown for moving California DSP&S and high-tech centers forward in their formative years. Their contributions cannot be overstated. So I just want to make sure we share that with you guys.
And both of their personalities helped it to be persistent through a period of more than 10 years. So we all had a chance to benefit from the end products that are not ended yet, so we can keep going with new things. Oh,
and
my
so
gosh.
Support services, we have three images on the screen. One shows a classroom instructor teaching in a 1970s classroom with lovely orange and yellow chairs that were there in the 2000s when I was there.
Yes.
And then the other two images are of Jeff Lenham and Sandy Bartiromo, who are, go ahead.
The teacher in the picture.
The teacher in the picture is also Jeff. But it was an opportunity for El Camino College to develop other areas of expertise. The High Tech Center was emerging, and also services to deaf and hard of hearing. And it was the beginning stages of establishing curriculum designed for deaf and hard of hearing students, which are now educational assistance courses and continuing to be taught at El Camino College. as well as a interpreter training program that provides training for students in interpreter, sign language interpreter program. During the time, this was the early years in the development of both of these programs, providing some synergy by having an interpreter training program, an ITP, as well as a large number of students who are deaf taking courses to pursue their education, supporting them in English courses as well as math courses. And eventually, the ITP program had a grant from the Office of Special Education and Rehabilitation Services that served the whole Western region for training interpreters from all the way up to Washington, Oregon, California, and Hawaii, American Samoa, Guam, and Saipan. So El Camino was very established in the interpreter training world as that population continued to be served and still has a strong ITP program today under the directorship of Gary Fairhope.
Was that the 70s, that picture you said?
Yes.
If you take a look at the video camera that's next to Jeff in the image.
Yeah, late 70s.
Yeah.
This one's a little late.
Is it later?
It said 70s, early 80s.
Okay.
Because otherwise it was in a smaller classroom before.
Oh, okay.
But the technology is much older.
Yeah. We had Maria Sheehan that worked in our office, who became a vice chancellor of the Sacramento area.
We're still trying to date some of them, but it was interesting. The orange and yellow chairs were still there when I
in the
late 90s. So one of the this picture is showing the importance of partnership. Dr. Steve Fasteau is on the left and Ray Lovell's on the right, and you see smiling faces of two gentlemen who work together in partnering to establish the funding as well as the institutional support, and then of course the ultimate success of students. And Steve's motto was really to work together in partnership, and he had a way of bringing administrators in on the discussion. There are times in which he had kid gloves on, and there were other times that he had a hammer. So really takes that partnership, working together softly and providing education and advocacy, and continuing to work with administrators to assure no discrimination and equal rights for students with disabilities. And I love this picture because it truly is the way that they approach their partnership, laughing and smiling through the challenges of good times and bad times.
Now I'm off to Cape Ed. Now I found this article in months of all kinds of stuff, and it's a CAPED personal account by Stephen R. Fasteau, and it was part two of Building CAPED, and it was the CAPED Journal, Volume 1, Issue 2, 1984. And we handed out a copy for all of you to see, and there's more up here, and we have some large ones up front too. I recommend for everybody to read it. There's some interesting things in there that I think apply to today. And we wanted to just pick out one part and share with you.
And we'll make this available as well as the PowerPoint presentation through the Dropbox for the convention.
Yes. So images on the screen, we're showing on the left, you'll see Welcome Second Annual CAPED Dimension. And I'm guessing that was hand-done because it looks like it was. Do you want to talk about the pictures here? We have Steve talking in front of a podium at the Sheraton Harbor Island Hotel, because this was in San Diego.
Yes, and he really wore that outfit, and the wallpaper was really that busy. Times have changed, hasn't it?
And the image on the top right is Steve Fasteau handing an award to.
Okay, we have the Latterman Scholarship, and there's also the Latterman Act for adult disabled having access to education and employment. And that's part of the partnership that Steve and Bob and Carl and all those others did was meet with legislators. They were also about the same age as well, and as they went into legislation, they made sure they kept their relationships going. So this is Steve giving a recognition to Senator Latimer, on the second, in the second annual meeting. So right at the beginning, Steve and Ray really tried to make sure that that partnership went through statewide appearances. And KPED is one of those things that allows us to be statewide appearing, even if we're on our campus and we don't show up for the convention or not. But you can use the connection to legislation and activity in that same way. So this is one of the ones that we wanted to honor Latterman, make sure he keeps thinking of us in legislation. When they decided to close down some of the state hospitals, it was nice to be able to contact him. He's going, what are they doing? They're reinterpreting it? Okay. And so it does help. The networking does work, and it does make differences. But it also requires all of us to be kind of diligent on what do I have access to. How many of you called your cancer's office, Linda, when she came in on came into business and said hi and introduced yourself? Has anyone called? I have. Learning from Steve, I have no boundaries, but I don't think I ever have them. One of the things working with Steve is you meet these people at conventions, you meet these people in workshops, and they're the ones that send you the emails. You can call and ask your questions. And ever since I was in the 70s,
way back when,
you can call up people and ask your question, like, okay, what were you thinking of when this mandate came down on your letter, and what do you really want me to do with it? Most of them will respond, and most of them will tell you what's happening. So he's one that was very good at just call them up and find out what's happening.
So the Latterman Award exists today. It's the highest award given by KPED. So you have to come to tonight's award ceremony and see who's the recipient of this year, 2018 Latterman Award.
And it goes to someone who's been active in advocating
for individuals with disabilities, having a huge influence across the state or the nation and serving the students with disabilities.
So when they call for candidates, think of somebody in your community or yourself or somebody that you think would be worthy to be considered, send it in, and give them a bigger pool to work with.
So to give you the history, continue to support KPED. In order for KPED to remain strong, it requires you, one, being a member, and by coming to the convention, you are a member of KPED. It requires you time to devote to the organization and continue the efforts. KPED is an affiliate of HED, even though KPED came first and HED came later. HED is the National Association, or the Association of Higher Education and Disability. And we work together with AHEAD to help support legislative measures that are on a national-wide basis, and of course to continue the advocacy for individuals with disabilities, the commitment to serve, because KPED is your organization and it's a volunteer organization.
We also have a handout for this list as well.
Did you share with them how KPED got involved with legislative actions?
No,
okay. So there was a higher education consulting or advisory council that would work with the legislatures on students with services for students with disabilities. And then all of a sudden, you know how California legislature likes to change things up? They decided to get rid of that, which meant there was no community entity coming up or advisory council that's going to be working with legislators are asking about how do they determine their priorities when they're looking at legislation. And that's where the 70s come in with the little Jedi's that we're all following, is they, no problem, let's make a group, let's start. We can become a professional organization, let's call ourselves KPED, okay, let's all go to Sacramento. And up they went, and they did it. And they've been doing it now for 30 years. And I have to say, it has saved some of our butts big time in what they've been able to do. and the rally of our students to be able to go up for legislation. We're one of the few groups that have students show up and do testimonies in legislation. So it is kind of a fun thing to do. We're no longer grassroots, but it still happens. So when you get that email from someone saying, hey, political action is needed, Santa Barbara, Lori, I have to give her kudos. She has little packets that she gives to her students and sample letters and that type of stuff. And so if you just get on her listserv or her email, you get the resource, and then you just have to replicate it for your own students. It makes it very easy.
Stay in touch with KFED. And this is the list of KFED presidents, your leaders through the years, providing legacy all the way from the beginning years in 1975 with Dr. Steve Fasteau. You'll see there's also Dr. Bob Hewlett in the mid-2000s, early 2000s. And I'm on there.
Yeah.
So El Camino had actually two KFED presidents. I'm proud of that. And the only reason is because Steve was still working at El Camino College when I was there and encouraged me to get involved with KFED and encouraged me to become president. So it was through Steve and his mentorship to me as a new director coming into the community colleges to stay involved with KFED. So this list is actually available to you in your KFED communique. The KFED communique is KFED's publication that provides information about best practices and what's happening across the state. Don't be embarrassed to contribute. We want your articles. Tell us about what's happening on your campus. If you have something new and innovative to attend, you know, to help others know about, we want your articles.
So we mentioned earlier about some of us retiring, some that retired and moved on. So we have an image of Steve Fasteau, which he's known for this image. Where he's in front of a microphone talking to a group with his hand next to his ear going, what are you saying?
They never had a deaf ear.
So what's next? So again, this piggybacks on what Lucinda will be saying all during this presentation. We want you to be involved. And in more ways than just local. I myself, one of the reasons you don't see me on here as an advocate, Jedi Advocate, because I don't feel like I've done that yet. So I'm making my commitment to step outside my comfort zone of just inside of, you know, college and local areas to be more involved. So I will be working on my Jedi training very soon.
Yes,
and you'll need it. So that maybe I can get my role.
Don't have the robe yet.
Nope. So again, who's willing to volunteer? We talked about the mentorship program. What else? Advocacy with the systems. You want to add anything here, Lyn?
I was going to say, I grew legged, but I gave credit, so it's all legal. For KPED Jedi Advocacy partnership. Where if you want something to follow, where you can pick somebody that's either on your campus or across KFED in some other area, where you can keep tabs with each other. The recommendation is that you also look at your SIGs and ask the SIG chairs if they're willing to work on a mentoring type of program similar to what the management did. Lucinda said she would steward and mentor any of the SIG chairs who are interested in doing that in their SIGs. And we're going to try to keep posting up information for you to make it easier for you to follow or to create what's going to be uniquely needed for your SIGs. I would highly recommend one of the best things I've gotten out of KFED in knowing Steve and Lucinda and all of you guys. In fact, most everybody I know in the room, I have to say thank you because you broaden your knowledge base by knowing the people that you don't need to know. I know her, I value what she has to say, I like her program, it's been a number of years since I've seen her, but part of it had to come out of an assignment I had to go do something at Pasadena City College and work collaboratively with each other. So sometimes taking those opportunities to connect up with professionals in areas that you may not be familiar with, you can also groom to become on the list of presidents. Not that hard to do.
That's right.
And I'm making a commitment to find Chad Bowen. I don't know if you're not from here, no. Because he's from Golden West. Mm. Do you know if he knows American Sign Language? Because if he does, he can go meet the Jedi Paul Colton.
That's right.
And Paul, not right now, his verbal processing is a little confusing. You think he might be a little ding dong. But he is right in on it with the ASL because that's his first language.
So there's many statewide changes that are going to be impacting students with disabilities. Now is the time to become a strong advocate. Our voices are going to be really important with the implementation of some of the Chancellor's Office initiatives, guided pathways, multiple measures, open educational resources, and free textbooks. All of those have an implication for the importance of accessibility for students with disabilities, and the message needs to be conveyed by all of us so that it doesn't go unheard. Stay tuned to KPED's efforts to help in providing the leadership, but the strength of the membership is what makes our voice the strongest, and it will really be critical to stay attuned to the measures that are taking, especially when the Chancellor, the community college's funding formula is changing across the board for all community colleges. Not the DSPS funding formula, but the funding formula that will be based on success and completion, not just FTES. So there's many initiatives. It requires all of us to work together to partner in the community of KPED so that we can assure that our students continue to get the funding that they need to be successful.
And connect that with others that you might trust their information or give you good information or wording to use. Because some of the items, you cannot wait for a DSP&S to be contacted for, oh, we're doing this and we've got it almost all done, can you now check it for us? Mm-hmm. We're not the check and balance for the institutional responsibility for access, and that's done through the procurement and the institutional commitment that your institution has done at the procurement level and at the administrative level. If that's not solid, you will end up with products coming into your campus that will have to be retrofitted. And we're now, I would have to say, 30 years is too long to keep retrofitting.
That's right.
So if
we cannot fix it.
Yeah, if we're passive on campus by not thinking that we have the ability to communicate with those entities, practice. Pick the VP that you don't even want to see ever again. Visit in their office and say, hey, I understand you're working with purchasing our VCAP program. I really want to encourage you to include this part of it too, because I find it very helpful when we buy software that's already accessible and usable for our students. And it's just a culture shift and change. So strongly, are you sitting by people you know? Talk to one person before you leave that you don't know and ask them two questions. You can pick the two you want. Or you can pick these two. Why are you going to take that?
Yeah, so we're out of time. There are a lot of pictures that we were able to show you, so go get the PowerPoint. I want to share one last slide as we fly through all these images from KPED.
And if you know anybody in there, email us back with the names.
Oh, nice.
So
I'm going to end with one last picture, and this is our last one. Steve, may your force continue to inspire. So thank you guys for coming.
I just wanted to add to that and what Lucinda was saying, that there are a lot of new initiatives that are starting. There are new people in the Chancellor's Office that weren't around in the history of this day. So they need to be educated. One of the main things we need to remember is community colleges is public education, it's open access. There is no threshold. Our CSUs have a threshold which consists of ACTs and SATs. Community colleges were never set up that way. It was an open door and it's accessible. We need to make sure that that stays that way. So it's very, very important with these new initiatives that Lucinda was talking about, with the onset implementation of AB 705, that we make sure that community colleges stick to the philosophy of being an open door and completely accessible college. So I hope to carry on. Steve? Steve's legacy as the director, 2.5 years of DSPS services at El Camino College and the ASL Interpreter Training Program. I'm excited and ready to take a lightsaber.
How many of you know?